from the bush and we're back in town.
Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Boy from the Bush, written by Lee Kernaghan with Colin Buchanan and read by David Tredinnick. I've journeyed to stars. I've wandered alone in search of the only love I've known. But deep in your eyes, I see an old friend, and I know in my heart I've found you again. Dedication. To my soulmate Robbie and our sons Jet and Rock. Prologue. When you turned the corner into Indiana Court, there it was. The beautiful chaos of trailers, caravans, cars and clutter. What had happened to this quiet country town cul-de-sac? It was Darwin after Cyclone Tracy, Brisbane after the floods of 74. Indiana Court, Albury, looked like a primer for a telethon, ready for a desperate call to an army of volunteers who could come and help with the clean-up effort. It was a disemboweled carnival, a gypsy jamboree, a crossbred mishmash of auction, car boot market and clearing sale. Flotsam had invaded every square inch of bare ground, covering verge and lawn and driveway with toolkits, suitcases, tarps and trusses. Lighting bars, par cans, road cases and monitor speakers, generators, trestles and tents, and a licorice spaghetti of every conceivable wire, lead and cable known to man. There was grease on a torn, white-trimmed blue Ford T-shirt. Sweat-painted dirt on forehead, cheek and jowl. There were skinned knuckles and scraped shins. Scrapes and grazes dusted dark, seasoned with road grime and dust. Sweaty singlets and a man on each corner, heaving and straining with shouts of, "To me! To me! Back your way! Steady! Steady!" The chorus that marks the clash of ancient foes. Stuff to pack versus available space. Months and months worth of stuff. The Kernaghans were packing, all right. We were packing like we'd never packed before. Not a horse float of PA gear and instruments heading out for a couple of dates out in Narrandra way and back. The trucks, conventional diesel-powered and rocket-propelled, the six-berth Millards, the pop-top Windsors, the twin-axle Chesneys, the multiple families, kids, dogs, staging, PA gear and miscellany. They all engulfed the whole street for one good reason. Tomorrow, Ray Kernaghan's cavalcade of stars would take two right turns and set sail up the Wagga Road, past the cheerful Come Again bolted to the back of the Lions Club and Apex signs on the Lavington edge of town. We were leaving the familiar waters of Albury, chasing the Hume Highway horizon northwards, off on a relentless string of border crossing, six nights a week shows. That night, there was no restless excitement. I fell asleep the moment my head hit the pillow. A sign of things to come. The stiff-limbed, fuzzy-headed fog of fatigue was still lingering early next morning as a lumbering 4x4 picked up a fair head of steam and cruised over the crest. We were not quite 15 minutes from home. Loaded to the gunwales, we formed the rearguard of the 12-caravan, barnstorming, jet truck-powered Kernaghan family country music tour of Australia. We were away. Dad motored on up ahead with Mum and the other kids, Greg, Tanya and Fiona. With no room left in the Chevy Silverado for me, I was assigned a ride with some of the crew, and there we were, all of us bobbing in time to the warp and woof of the suspension, our backs sticking to the seats. The hot breath of the merciless Riverina summer swirled its blustery gusts from out over the stubbled paddocks and up off the baking bitumen, through the open windows, and tousled our hair in a mad, windswept dance. 9 Mile Hill is barely a landmark around the New South Wales Murray River town of Albury. Most people are either nearly there or barely gone when, like us, they ride its forgettable flanks on the way north to Wagga, or first spot the lights of town heading south. But that little stretch of the Olympic Way has become part of Kernaghan family folklore. Not that my mind was on the road at that moment. Like everyone, I was excited that we were finally on our way. Ray Kernaghan's cavalcade of stars was an ambitious undertaking. TV advertised and promoted in advance, it was an 8-month, virtually non-stop ramble from showground to showground. We'd eventually reach as far north as Mossman near the tropical Daintree and as far west as Cloncurry in the Queensland outback. Like the tarps, tents and trappings, the talent was locked and loaded. Of course, Dad was the star of the show. Ray Kernaghan, the multi-gold award-winning star of country music. It was a family affair, and we all had special titles. I may have been musical director, sound man and roadie, but for 30 minutes every show, I was the dynamic Lee Kernaghan. My sister was Tanya Kernaghan, the sweetheart of country music. Our drummer, my brother Greg, was Mr. Beat. Special guests included Julie Perry, Australia's Miss Truckin' Music, and Eureka Smith as the man in black, Johnny Cash. It was all backed up by the Jet Set Country Band. Everyone was pitching in, not just to entertain, but to lug and haul, set up and pack away. We even had our own school teacher for the tribe of kids that was along for the tour. For many, perhaps the biggest draw card in Dad's cavalcade was Waltzing Matilda, the jet-powered fastest truck on earth, officially clocked in the back blocks of Victoria, doing 330 kilometres per hour over the flying mile. I was nearly 18 and had a front row seat for the next unpredictable chapter of my adventure in music and showbiz, rolling my way down Nine Mile Hill. At first, it seemed like we were swerving to miss a pothole. Perhaps that's how it began. I glanced across to see our driver snap a little straighter in the driver's seat and slap both hands more firmly on the wheel. The swerve became a side-to-side drift, with each arc becoming more violent until it all shifted into that surreal, out-of-control, happened-really-quickly slow motion which seems to accompany high-speed mishaps. The tank slapping became more violent, and the caravan flipped, wrenching the vehicle into the verge, spitting dust and gravel as we left the road, still careering ahead, but feeling a slow and unstoppable tilting of the cab. In the moment when the caravan was either sheared from the tow ball or simply obliterated by the impact, I remember feeling the deceleration, like the final slowing exhale of the roller coaster. As the world returned to real time, I remember looking at a cracked, tipped-on-its-end world, feeling the heat again, the smell of fuel and singeing oil, the ticking of the hot exhaust and a fragile, "Is everyone okay?" Someone ahead had seen the disaster unfold and had radioed the convoy. Dad said he rounded the corner to see our freshly rolled patrol on its roof and the shattered, scattered ex-caravan strewn up and down the road. Shaken, but unhurt, we clambered out and onto the roadside. Many times over the years, I heard Dad describe how he felt at the sight of us all, dazed and still in shock, surrounded by the debris. He said he still can't believe no one was injured or killed. As he'd so often done in the days before and since, Dad met misfortune with the dogged determination of a drover's son who knew you had to take whatever life throws at you. Taking matters in hand, Dad called in the tow truck and the clean-up began, the crew bobbing like chooks along the roadside, salvaging whatever we could of our belongings. We limped back to Albury, sunburnt, shaken and exhausted. And so the sun set on day one. Day two saw us regroup, and around midday, Albury once more slipped into our wake. There was no time to spare. The first show was booked, and Kempsey was still a good 2 days' drive away. Ray Kernaghan led from the front, onwards and upwards. Of course, Dad didn't know what the months ahead held. the 22 flat tyres in 1 week in Western Queensland. A second caravan, the twin axle Chesney, engulfed in flames, ignited by a welder's spark. The storms, the lean nights, the last minute mishaps, the blackouts, debacles and near misses. On that tour, and in the years that followed, I've come to learn that a life in country music has its fair share of 9 mile hills. Not all of them quite so dramatic, destructive, or potentially deadly as that January morning, but each of them enough to get you doubting yourself, thinking that perhaps you're backing the wrong horse, wondering if the safer and more sensible option might be the better choice after all. But I had no time for navel-gazing that day. We all may have been a little the worse for wear, but Ray Kernaghan's cavalcade of stars had a gig to get to. We were back in business. Destination, Kempsey Showground. A good couple of days' drive through to Sydney and up the then freeway-less Pacific Highway. The tales of those amazing 8 months may be told one day, but as we Kernaghans look back on the whole thing, we all agree. Never in our lives have we worked harder than we did on that run. But as the months unfolded, I knew that the thousands of kilometres I'd travelled and the hundreds of songs I'd played was a delicious whiff of the possibility. A life in country music. It was like I'd scraped together the deposit. I decided to see if a music career was something I could actually own for myself. As the tour headed towards its final show at the Nambour Showground, I knew it wouldn't be long before everyone would start heading their separate ways. While I still had a band at my fingertips, I thought I'd make the most of it. The huge annual Tamworth Country Music Festival hosted the biggest talent quest in Australia, Toyota's Star Maker. Winning Star Maker would be a fast track into the career in country music I so keenly wanted. But I faced a critical hurdle. Along with biographical material and promotional photographs, the application process required entrants to supply recordings of 2 songs. Being on the road, I had no access to a recording studio, so during soundcheck at the Caboolture Showground, we set up a small portable cassette recorder on the sound desk and captured 2 tunes I'd recently penned in show sheds and stables along the way. The entry was packaged up and dispatched from the Caboolture post office. Within days, the cavalcade began to scatter as the crew started to wend their separate ways home from Nambour. Dad and the family stuck around, continuing their vagabond life, shifting between caravan parks for some months. I decided to stay with them in Queensland, doing covers gigs up and down the coast to pay the bills. My first permanent gig was at the Greenmount Beach Resort in Coolangatta, playing 4 days per week. But a new chapter was about to unfold. One day, in mid-1982, I received a letter postmarked Tamworth and bearing the blue logo of BAL Marketing, congratulating me on reaching the final 20 of Star Maker. After a hard year of paying my musical dues, I knew I had to grasp this opportunity with everything I had. I couldn't wait for the October long weekend to roll around. Dad stayed back to mind the trucks and equipment as Mum, my younger brother Greg and I crossed the border into New South Wales. As each mile passed, all I could think about was that looming Star Maker grand final. The field of hopeful contenders was culled until finally the envelope was opened and the silence of anticipation was broken. Star Maker for 1982 is Lee Kernaghan. The Tamworth Town Hall erupted in applause. This is what I'd dreamed of. And here I was, stunned and delighted, attempting to cobble some words together for an acceptance speech. What immediately followed was a whirlwind of cameras, spotlights, and thrusting microphones. I ricocheted between print, radio, and TV interviews as the media swarmed around me. Next day, Mum at the wheel, all three of us high as kites, we headed back to Nambour. Doors opened as I recorded my double A side winner's single, Advance Australia Again, and Cheaters, a song inspired by the hit US TV series Dallas. God save the cheaters. God save.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.